Well, welcome gentlemen, back to East End Park. It's nice to see you here. We've got Graham Shaw and Jim Brown. Can we start with you first, Graham, because you were here the longest and you were signed in 1971 at that time.
Yeah, that's right.
And you were only 20, I think?
Yeah, that's right.
So you were playing junior at that time because you were signed from Musselburgh Athletic.
That's right. For the year junior, we had a successful season, won the East Junior League, and there was a scout, Ned McGeechan, whose name you may remember. I think he'd come to watch myself and another guy I played up front with, a guy, Mickey Lawson, who went on to be senior with St Johnstone, Stirling Albion. I think the idea was, Ned told me later on that he wanted both of us, but never quite worked out that way. Which would have been good, because I had a good relationship with Mickey. We scored lots of goals together, which obviously got me the opportunity to sign for Dunfermline.
Who was it that actually signed you? Was it, was it George Miller?
I think it was Alec Wright originally.
But then he left quite soon. And then it would have been George Miller that would have come in then.
It was George Miller that gave me my opportunity in the first team, yeah.
Can you remember your debut?
I can, actually. It was Dundee, and I think it was a League Cup tie.
At Dens,
that's right.
It was a defeat.
Can't remember the score, but I think we did lose, yeah.
1-0, it was all 1-0.
1-0, that's right. Yeah. I remember it really because they played me on the left wing, which was not really, it was a bit of a surprise to me, but I wasn't going to say anything, obviously, because I was getting a game in the first team. But they had Barry Mitchell, who played in a role that I would really be wanting to play or looking to play. So I ended up out in the left wing, which didn't quite work out as I'd hoped, but it was just, it was fantastic.
So who was here then when you played initially when you first came? You said that Leash was here then, was he?
Yeah.
He'd already signed?
Yeah, they were all there when I first arrived and played in the reserves. Kenny Thompson, Bonner was here. From the old team, John Arrow was a goalkeeper, still he was there. John Cushley was still there. Jim Fraser, John Lunn, still here. That's
Bert.
Probably about it. Bert
Kane, yeah. And I think Willie Callaghan might have just been here and then he left to go to Berwick.
He left, that's right. And the rest of them were the young guys who eventually came through and played in the first team.
Because that first season that you arrived here, we were relegated to the second division.
Yeah, that was the 71-72 season, yeah.
And then in 72-73 in the second division, we ended up winning promotion. But that was a team where there was a lot of young guys playing then.
That's right.
Because a lot of the older ones who had been here for the 60s were left, had moved on, whatever. And you young guys took over.
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe George Miller made a lot of changes and gave the youngsters an opportunity. And from the, it helped to think that we were all playing together in the reserves as well. So we all had a good camaraderie. We all got on really well, and I think that probably helped. Jim Leishman, Kenny Mackey, Kenny Thompson, I think was probably one of the first youngsters to get his chance, and he took it. And then it was Jim Wallace, Jim Scott, myself. So there's about half a dozen of us all got first team positions. And they signed Alec Kinnunmonth from Dundee, who was the... Yeah, he was still probably quite young, but he was the elder statesman.
I was going to say, Jim Gillespie was the old player.
There was only a couple of them, John Earl, the goalkeeper.
Yeah.
And Dave McNichol was here as well, of course. Who was at Arts with us as well, eventually. So Yeah, it was great, and it all went swimmingly well.
You formed a partnership with Ken Mackey.
Yeah.
And the two of you put in some amount of goals for Dunfermline.
Well, we scored, over 100 goals, I think, that season. Yeah, we're winning 8-0 and 7-0, and you know, we were scoring goals for fun.
Mm-hmm.
I think I got 26 that season. Kenny got 22 or something, so we nearly got 50 goals between us.
Yeah.
And it was great for me because, as I said to you earlier on, that in my days at Musselburgh with Mickey Lawson, I'd had a good partnership as well, and we scored lots of goals, so it was good to be able to do that with another player as well. And, you know, we didn't know one another, so you know, it was a little bonus to be able to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But we just seem to know each other's...
I was going to say, does it just sometimes click with a player that you've got to get this...
Yeah, I think it does, yeah. I mean, I think that's absolutely right. It's very difficult to explain because, as Jim will know, when you're on the football park, you don't actually have time to actually look around and think and see where you are. So it's an automatic thing almost, subconscious thing. And luckily enough, it worked well.
What happened when you got to Tynecastle?
Well, the reason... What happened is at Tynecastle is that I was never able to actually form a partnership with somebody as I had done at my other two previous clubs. That was the reason for it. But Hearts was different. But we're not here to talk about Hearts, are we?
No, not really. But that's how you two came together, I suppose, really.
Yeah.
You know one another.
Well, I used to go and... Jim's a bit older than me, so I used to go and watch this guy at... playing for Hearts because
you were a Hearts supporter.
I still am, yeah. I was brought up a Hearts fan, so I used to go away. So I knew of them.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. One of the games that I can remember then you probably played in it was a game against Stenhousemuir. Stenhousemuir.
Uh-huh.
And George, and pitch was brick hard, and George Miller had you playing in tracksuit bombs.
Yeah.
And I think you got a lot of stick for that.
We got a lot of stick for that, yeah. We were getting, there was lots of comment about it. I mean, it looked like tights from a distance. That was the problem, because we had the tracksuit bottoms tucked inside the socks, because we had to show our socks. That was the rule.
Mm-hmm.
So we were getting wolf whistles as we ran out. And of course, the crowd wouldn't have been particularly big at Stenhousemuir, so you hear everything. But it was supposed to... It backfired slightly. It was supposed to actually give us confidence because it was hard ground and we were just going for slight tackles and not worry about, you know, ripping our flesh. But it backfired a little bit because I think the players were embarrassed more than anything else. I don't think he ever repeated that.
No. But I remember, like, you won.
We did win. So he could probably prove it.
Proved that it worked. There was a lot of high-scoring games that season when you won promotion, and then I think at the end of the season you went on a tour of Norway.
Yes.
Is that right?
That's right, yeah.
So, have you got any stories to tell? Maybe about a Mr. Leishman?
I don't know if I can actually tell. I've got lots of stories I can tell about Mr. Leishman, but not a lot of them I can put on... on record, unfortunately.
It would be quite good to get one about Mr. Leishman rather than him telling us about his goal at Ibrox.
Right, okay, I could probably tell you. I could tell you one, I think, which is reasonable.
Mm-hmm.
Leish was always the dapper dresser in those days. And it was Trondheim we were playing, Rosenborg Trondheim. And what the clubs did after the games is that they laid on a little drinks thing for you after it. So Leish had bought this Kraken suit, which was pinstripe, big pinstripe, the 12, 14 inch vents. Most people got 12 inch vents, he got 14 because it's Leish. So the big flare trousers that covered your shoes, and he had the big platform heels, and he says, "I'm saving it for the reception after the game." So we're all in the reception, and there's a lot of people, and there's a lot of young girls there as well, young Norwegian girls. So no sign of Leish. Eventually, after everybody was in, sitting down. He was the last to come in, so in about 15 minutes after everybody else. And he waltzes with his suit, comes up to where we were all sitting, slides on the table, and goes, "Hi, I'm Jim Leishman, pleased to meet you, Garlson." So what he didn't realise was there were candles on the table, so his 14-inch vent had gone over a candle, and all we could see was smoke coming up, and we were going, "Should we tell him?"
No.
So we thought we should tell him, and eventually we so that's one I can't tell.
What was he like then as a player, Jim? Because we know what he's like now when he stopped playing, and when he was also manager of the club. But what was he like as a player playing with him?
He was a good player. Obviously, his career was cut short because of his bad leg break. But he was similar in some ways to Jim, like a lot of energy. And you know, in those days when we first started playing the game, defenders never really used to come over the, you know, the halfway line. A lot of defenders just defended, and that was it. You know, Jim was one who would join you in attack and overlap. And Jim was the other Jim Leishman was similar to that, and. He'll say that if you speak to him, that he got me my transfer to Hearts because he kept putting in cross balls for me to score a goal. So, he's, you know, it's like he always has an angle. But he was very good, very promising. It's a pity, obviously, that he had his accident, and we would just never know how far he could have gone.
He probably would have moved on.
I suspect he would have.
That season when you were promoted, you went into the first division then, and then stayed up, and then there was changes again at the team because you had the likes of Jackie Sinclair, I think, came back to the club.
That's right.
As another old head.
That's right.
And you had young Alan Evans.
Yes.
And I think we had Geir Carlson in goal.
We did.
Now you set up that night for about Geir.
Geir was a Norwegian international goalkeeper with 50 odd caps or something, you know, so we thought that we were obviously getting a really top goalkeeper, and he was a good lad, a funny lad, but sometimes he made some howlers, which cost us quite a bit. But
is there any that stand out?
I can't recall anything specifically that I remember, but I remember playing Celtic, and Jim Brogan, the left back, saying to me that we had him on trial. He says he was something or something, or worse to that effect. So I think we'd Celtic beat us 6-0 or something, and Geir, it wasn't one of Geir's finest days, but he was only here for a few years, and I think and went back, but interesting chap.
In season 74-75 there was going to be changes in the league setup, but we actually ended up in the bottom half of the league, and then
we started in the top, and then
gradually slipped down.
Yeah, we went on we were doing well, and it looked as if we were going to make, I can't remember if it was top 10 or 12 at that time, but looked like we were going to make it easily, and we just went on this bad run around about Christmas, New Year time, and slipped out of the top 10, and I think that was really the death knell at the time of the club, unfortunately.
Yeah.
I think we were really hoping that we would be able to get into the top league, and all the benefits that came from that.
Yeah, it was going to be the top 10, it was going to be a Premier League, and then it was Premier
That's
League
right.
in the First Division.
That's right,
What would you, you scored a lot of goals, so what would you say was maybe the best goal that you scored?
I think probably best goal was at Parkhead when we played in the league match there, and Celtic just beat us 2-1 with, I think, Jimmy Bone scored late on. So that would have been an excellent performance, obviously, with how good Celtic were at the time. And I remember it because it was about a 30-yarder, and Kenny Mackey had the ball and been tackled by Billy McNeil, and it ran free. And I think it was Connolly was the other centre back. He came towards it, so I skipped round Connolly and hit it from the 30 yards, top corner, and everybody, there was a reaction, like a delayed reaction. Everybody went, it was my right foot. So that's how I remember it. So a delayed reaction, and everybody also went mad. So that's probably the best goal I think I scored. It's the one that gives me good memories. But I mean, I scored loads of hat tricks in that season, and they were it's always good to get a hat trick. So I mean, I remember them. Forfar was Queen of the South, a hat trick as well, and
You think, looking back on your time here, did you enjoy it?
I loved it. I really did. I mean, I was Edinburgh born and bred. I had never really done. I knew what I know about Fife. I knew Dunfermline and Kirkcaldy were two towns, and Burnt Island from going on family holidays when I was a kid to the caravan sites, and that was it. So I didn't really know much about Fife, and I have to admit, meeting Fifers for the first time was a strange. I thought they were like from the moon. They were just totally different from Edinburgh people, and but you know, they all made me really welcome. And as time went by, I used to spend most of my Saturday nights after games, you know, in Fife with Leash and the rest of the guys, and socialising here. They were a great bunch of guys. We had a little bit of success on the park, not as much as I would have hoped, but yeah, I mean, I'd be forever grateful to the club for giving me an opportunity to go on and eventually play for Hearts, the team I supported, you know, which was a dream come true. So yeah, I've good memories. It's always great coming back.
How did that move come about then to Hearts? Because the connection with you and Jim Brown. So how did the move from Dunfermline to Hearts go?
I think there was, I never used to bother too much about what was made, you know, in the papers, but there was always talk, because I was scoring a lot of goals, people come and look at you. And I think that I was told that Hearts had put an offer in, and I think that Dunfermline at that time, because obviously we never made it into the top league, were quite happy to sell, so. They said, "Would you like to go?" And I'm thinking, "Yes, I probably would like to go."
Being a Hearts supporter,
tell the truth.
Okay, what's the truth?
The truth was, when Hearts were playing Dunfermline here, you were in the Hearts end with your Hearts stars one.
No, leave that to the Derek Ravens and the Griffiths. I would never do that. Although it was,
you dropped the Miller spot, did you?
It was quite funny, because being a Hearts fan after. All the games I played with Dunfermline, the first thing I used to do is come in and say, "What was the Hearts score?" And this eventually got a little bit annoying to most of the players and the staff. But there was one particular game after playing Cowdenbeath. We'd beaten Cowdenbeath at Cowdenbeath. Came in after the game, and they're all lined up, and they're all like, a big smile on their face. I'm sorry about this, Jim, but I'm going, and they're like, "I hadn't said anything. Do you want to know the Hearts score then?" And I'm going, "Okay, this is not normal." Hibs beat Hearts 7-0. And I went, no, I'm not having that. So they took great delight in telling me that result.
Oh, jings. So when you left us, you left in January 1976.
Yeah.
And I think George Miller had been sacked as well, and Harry Melrose.
That's right,
over.
Harry Melrose was
taken over.
Yeah.
So you went to Hearts, and this gentleman here, Jim Brown, was playing for Hearts at that time.
He was, correct. He was.
So you then, you were a bit of a main, you were captain of Hearts as
That's
well,
right,
weren't you?
Yeah.
And then in between Hearts and coming to Dunfermline, you went to Hibs.
Yeah, 2 years.
So, how did you two get on as players together at Tynecastle?
Shouted at him a lot.
Did you?
Yeah, he still does.
No, we're fine. We were at Tynecastle. When he joined, that was from over the end of that season, we qualified for Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And that was a great event for us. Hearts hadn't been in Europe for, well, I can't remember, many years.
Mm-hmm.
12, I think, something like that. And that was, you know, we played Lokomotiv Leipzig and we played Hamburg.
Mm-hmm.
And they were great events. Hamburg was something else.
Mm-hmm.
Manny Calops played for them, Felix McGath. And I'm trying to remember the...
Schaffen,
yeah.
Or something,
yeah,
some
yeah.
Dutch guy, I think, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then also the guy just come back from, or was that the same guy, got for taking him a bomb? He'd been banned for 12 months or something like that, or 18 months, and he came back. He was quite fast.
That's the guy, yeah. Schaffen.
Mm.
Yeah.
My German's not good.
No, so that's when we first picked up, and then we had the cup final together as well, which was a bit of a disaster.
Mm-hmm.
That was the final where we kicked off before 3 o'clock, and they scored before 3 o'clock. And unfortunately, it wasn't a foul. Jim Jeffries is not a good friend of ours.
Uh-huh.
It was supposedly, I think it was Derek Johnson pushed him,
yeah,
or something like that. It was the other way around.
Uh-huh.
And from that incident, crossed into the box, and the next thing it was in the net. So the game had hardly kicked off, and we were 1-0 down.
Mm-hmm.
Which was disappointing because we weren't that far off them.
No, I don't think we were. I mean, the Rangers were a good side, let's
yeah,
be honest about it, because I think they completed the treble when they, mm-hmm, when they beat us. And I think that, if you remember, the talk before the game was, we'll try and stop them from scoring,
yeah,
as long as possible. And of course, they scored,
yeah,
before the official, mm-hmm, kickoff time.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think that we then sort of had a pretty good next 40-odd minutes or so.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think it was Ali McDonald scored from a corner they got, and the ball was headed out of the box, and I think he scored. And
pretty much a miss it, and it went straight into the corner.
It went in the corner, that's right.
Mm-hmm.
So we were 2-0 down. It was...
But hadn't played like that.
No, exactly. I think it was
the
a
referee
little bit
was saying that in the way off. He says, Hearts, I could hear him saying to his linesman, he said, Hearts are still in this. He says,
yeah,
2 goals is not fair.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, it, mm-hmm, wasn't to be.
Yeah.
Did you score with your right foot?
I scored my right foot again, yeah, that's another one I remember. Consolation, unfortunately. Yeah.
Maybe I could ask you another question then. He says, how many hat-tricks did you get when you were at Hearts?
Just a couple for the reserves, I think. They just never played. Never played me to my strengths. I keep saying that.
Jim Jeffries, like as a player, because we had him here as a manager.
Very hard man.
Mm-hmm.
Very committed.
Mm-hmm.
Used to moan a lot.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Moan for Scotland. Yeah, he's a grumpy, nameless one there. But very committed player.
Mm-hmm.
A very underrated player.
Mm-hmm.
You got better in my eyes. Old, when he got older,
mm-hmm,
he matured. He started using that a wee bit more.
Uh-huh.
but yes, as you'll have known from his time here, that he was he didn't just call a spade a shovel, he called it a shovel. He was quite emphatic about things at times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
but that's why he did so well as a manager in the various, mm-hmm, clubs that he went to.
Yeah.
Bearing in mind that Jeff never really even went to any of the coaching schools.
Mm-hmm.
No, I mean, he's had a fantastic managerial career, you know, and he won Hearts the Cup for the first time for a long time,
mm-hmm,
which, you know,
mm-hmm,
he's now down
some
high level because of,
mm-hmm,
that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, Jim, your career here was short, unfortunately, because you left Hearts, went to Hibs, and I believe you're captain at Hibs as well.
Yeah.
And then you came to Dunfermline you were captain of Dunfermline as well. But I think you only made maybe about 13 or 14 appearances, is that right?
I would probably think that was about the case, because it was the end of October when it was all over. So we'd only have really got about that number of games in. I can't remember if we're first or second in the league at the time, or near the top. I know that. We didn't start the season too well, but we picked up, and the players were getting into the way of it. Me shouting at them mainly. So I see young Paul Donnelly. I was saying to Graham in the car and this morning that we needed to put a leash on him because he was wanted to run everywhere. And you had to get him to see you're in that position. But yeah, because he's a good player, but we just had to get him under control. So yeah, there was only about that. But we're doing well, we're going well.
Yeah, it was Pat Stanton that signed
you. Pat and George Stewart.
Because I'm assuming that they wanted you as a player because you were known as a, I would say, committed, hard fullback.
That's fair.
Yeah.
I didn't like losing. So that pretty much covers it.
Yeah.
You can play a bit as well, for example.
Yes.
Yeah.
But
not just
that. Yeah, but no, but you know, they obviously wanted someone who was who could
basically
get
what
stuck
Pat
in
and George room. Wanted was to me take what was off the park onto the park.
Yeah.
And get them into, I don't mean knock them into shape, but to get them into a good mindset, a winning mindset, and we're really just getting onto that. Beating Motherwell, who were other main, well, I think it was Falkirk, I'm trying to remember, who were all in the league then. But the big thing was to go for promotion. But unfortunately, after my injury, everything seemed to go pear-shaped.
Yeah, because again, there were young players as well at that time.
Yeah.
And they needed a more senior player or a couple of players to keep them, not in check, but to help them.
Yeah, well, the other senior players were Kenny Thompson and Boner, were the ones around, and then my Dr. Hugh and Dr. Bobby. Yes, I had to watch my P's and Q's when I swore at them. I swore politely.
I'm going to ask you if there was any games stood out for you. I know there's the particular game that you got your injury in, but is there any other time, because your career with Dunfermline was so short, is there anything that stands out for it?
I think it was the game against Motherwell here. It was a mark in the sand for the team and for the players. Because it had the mentality that if Motherwell was coming, well, we'll probably lose. Whereas my mentality was, no or no. And we started to get that. And you could see some of the young boys, you know, sort of start to pick up and be more confident in themselves. In other words, we can win this. And then a couple of games later, it was all over.
Yeah, no, I mean, I think any Dunfermline fan or any fan that was here at the time during that game and saw the tackle and the injury, because it was right in front of the dugouts. It was right by the halfway line, wasn't it? Yeah. Because I was standing not far from it. And it was a bad tackle.
Just a bit.
Yeah. Right. So, I mean, that then totally finished your career.
That was it. Finished the whole thing. Yeah. No chance. I still going to get 90 degrees bend in my leg. I had to have a second operation because my right leg was going bow-shaped. I had what they call a tibia osteotomy, which was taking a wedgie bone out the top of your leg and then to break your leg into the shape of it, so it flicks it out. That's how the straightened bottom. I'm slightly not needing it. That's it was just Graham was asking me many times I've been back. I've not been back very often at all because after the injury, I was kaput for a couple of years, and then I had to get further operation, and that was another year out. By that time, all the players that were here, the management had changed. Probably supporters had changed. So I've only been, back a few times, but not many. So mm-hmm. I'm really quite happy to be here today, to be honest. So I'm quite looking forward to it.
Good. And yeah, I mean, not really to talk about it, but you ended up taking out a civil action against John Pelosi, mm-hmm. which at that time, I'm assuming, was really quite rare for somebody to do that.
Yes, there have been one other chap in England, I forget his name of, now had started on the process but hadn't gone as far as I mm-hmm. had. I had to go and get legal opinion, and R.I. Sutherland, I seem to remember this chap's name, and his view was that without doubt I should go and mm-hmm. take him to court and the club. Mm-hmm. So it was a joint and several action.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the legal advice again, was settled out of court the day before. I wasn't for it. I wanted to go the whole way. However, outside pressures prevailed to say mm-hmm. that you don't know what might happen mm-hmm. in court. Although I couldn't see me losing, but you just never know. A quirk mm-hmm. of law could mm-hmm. have turned it all round. So mm-hmm. we settled the day before.
Yeah. Were you disappointed in the fact that did you feel that you at that time could have carried on for a few more years playing?
I was bum fit. Graham knows I was I trained.
Yeah.
I never shirked training. Mm-hmm. And to be honest, the older I was getting, the easier I was finding it.
That's unusual.
It's the fact that your brain, mm-hmm. you use a bit between your ears mm-hmm. a bit more. I mean, that's the fastest thing on the park. Mm-hmm. It's not Kenny Thompson, it's a mm-hmm. bit between your ears. Mm-hmm. And a contemporary of mine was Billy Jordan, as I know him. And Billy played on until he was 39.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I think I could have comfortably have done that as well.
Yeah.
No problem.
Yeah. So how old were you when you got injured?
I was 31 in the August.
Right.
So I would have, and Billy would be, he was 32 mm-hmm. at the time. So when I arrived here, I found out afterwards that Hearts were coming back for me the following week from when I signed from Dunfermline.
Oh, right.
The manager or whatever was on holiday or whatever, something like that. So it could have been Hearts, Hibs, Hearts. Mm-hmm. As it was Hearts, Hibs, Dunfermline, nowhere.
Yeah.
next day. Mm-hmm. But that's part of life. I enjoyed my time here, and brief as it was, mm-hmm. The supporters were excellent. Mm-hmm. There weren't so many of them then, mm-hmm. but we were getting results, and the crowds were gradually starting to pick up.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, mm-hmm. But unfortunately, that's not the way.
It
didn't go the whole way. So.
So you don't hold a grudge against Dunfermline then?
No. I always treat Dunfermline as a job I never finished.
Yeah.
My ambition mm-hmm. was to win the league. Mm-hmm. And go back up, but anyway, then it was mm-hmm. a few years after that Dunfermline struggled for.
That's right, we struggled again. Mm-hmm. Yeah, when you finished your career, Graham, you finished at Arbroath. Did either of you go into football once your playing days finished?
I had a spell in charge of Arbroath. Mm-hmm. But it was just really as cover. George Fleming, who was the last manager, who we'll know again, George was at Hearts as well, had just been given the push, so it was agreed that I would take over as interim manager in the period and mm-hmm. see mm-hmm. whether there was any future in me taking the job permanently. Mm-hmm. I have to admit, I didn't take to it, really. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it was because of the distance and travel. I was still living in Edinburgh, and by then I was part-time, going after a career in banking, mm-hmm. and doing bank exams, so mm-hmm. I had to travel up to Arbroath three or four times in the evenings, and I wasn't getting back till 2 or 3. So I think that's probably one of the reasons that I didn't pursue it any further. So eventually I gave up on it, and Jimmy Bone took over. He became the manager. So apart from that, I've never really had any incentive or thought to actually continue in the game. Having been a player, I've seen how flimsy an existence it is. So that's my reasons for it.
Yeah.
How
about you, Jim?
I never came back. I was struggling enough with my leg. And by that time, I had a full-time job, and my wife had often asked or said, you know, thought I'd be quite good at it, but why did you not? I said, well, if you thought you didn't see very much of me when I was playing, I said, you'll see even less of me if I'm a manager, if I'm going to do it properly. So I chose my family. I never went for that at all.
Are you glad you played football at the time you did?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, played a great time.
I wouldn't change the memories for anything. I mean, I know people always ask me this question. They say, you know, if you were playing now, you know, think of the money that's in the game. But, you know, you can't really make these comparisons. I mean, I think different eras, you know, you can't say, would he have been a good player then, or vice versa. The game's different now.
I mean, the time you played, the quality that was around, I mean, in Scotland, they're trying to pick a team. If you want the right back, you had a choice of six, goalkeeper six.
Yeah.
Played against the Lisbon Lions, played against the Rangers European Champions team. Forster played against Hamburg as well, who went on to win the trophy. I think he had 2 years in the trot, I think. So we played against a lot of the big English clubs and English players. Played against quite a few of the English World Cup winning team. So played at a great time with great players. It was always a challenge, and it's always nice to win.
Who was your most difficult opponent then, as a fullback? Who was?
My most difficult opponent was myself. No, I can't really pick anybody out that would have said what was the like that. I couldn't really say that I always had difficulty with this one. I just took every game. I played midfield for a good number of years as well, and as I said, as you get older, you get wiser and you think more, and you would think going to a game or on the bus going to a game, you'd roughly have an idea of who you were playing against, and you'd have a fair idea of their style, and then it was a matter of concentration. And if you got the better of you on the day, then they got the better of you, but the following time, I would make sure they didn't.
How about you, Graham? Which centre-half or that was?
I think Jim's explained it really, really well. I mean, you got... I don't think there's anybody I think that I've ever played against that has totally always dominated me to the point that I would say that, you know, I could never play against that person. As Jim says, you know, the next time you play, you know, there will be winners or losers on the day, but you have to learn by that, and hopefully the next time you come up against them, then you'll get the benefit. And you will always, even if you're having a hard time against somebody, you know, it's 90 minutes, you'll always have 5 minutes that you'll get an opportunity. So I don't think there's anybody that I would say that's really dominated me. I would say that there's quite a number of excellent players that I've played against, which Jim has covered. And it was more the... There was a certain type of centre-half, like the Billy McNeils and the guy who played for Rangers, his name Colin Jackson, people like that, who were just, you know, just hard and physical. Tom Forsyth springs to mind, another one. But it was the football playing centre-backs that really I thought were the most difficult, because, as Jim says, they used the brain. John Blackley springs to mind. Yeah. John Blackley was never a big, dominating, physical guy, but and he was never the quickest, but he knew you could see things. It's going back to this automatic idea where he knew where the ball was going to go and you were at run, you position, and he could play. You know, he could start. Mm-hmm. It was a new thing, a centre half actually starting attacks mm-hmm. by playing football, playing out or moving forward. So it was players like that. Mullen Hansen's probably another one as well, I would say. He was a football player. And as time went by, they became more and more common. Mm-hmm. Willie Miller and people like that. Mm-hmm. But nobody in particular, no.
Well, all I can say is, gentlemen, thank you for speaking to us on behalf of the Heritage Trust, and it's nice to see both of you back here at East End Park.
Thanks very much. Delighted to be back.
Thank you.